Hare Krishna. So, we are discussing the Bhagavad Gita, second chapter. Last time we discussed the second chapter where we talked about the distinction between body and soul. So, while talking about the distinction body and soul, nāsato vidyate bhāvo na bhāvo vidyate sataha ubhayor drashtvantas tvanayo sattva darshibhi, we came to the point of how the soul and body are distinct from each other, because the soul is eternal and the body is temporal. Even though you want to infuse the eternity to the body, it's not possible. So something which is impossible, we are all thinking it can be possible. That is our problem. That is, we want permanent house, permanent situations in this world, but it's impossible. This is known as Brahma, illusion. This is known as Vaikuntha Brahma. Brahma means illusion, something which is not there to be there. So permanent situation in this world is not there, but we all seek out. Not only we all seek out permanent situation, we have so much of faith that yes, I will have someday permanent life, permanent job, permanent people around me. And not only that, there is another Brahma which is called Vaikuntha Brahma. Vaikuntha Brahma means what? Vaikuntha Brahma means another Brahma means Ananda Brahma. Ananda Brahma means what? I'll be happy. So we are all trying to become happy and trying to have a permanent situation, which is impossible in this world. So after talking about soul and body, now the qualities of the body, qualities of matter, are not existing in the soul. To explain that, Krishna, he speaks a very beautiful verse, that is the second chapter, 20th verse. He says, na jayate mriyate va kadachit nayam bhutva bhavita vana bhuyaha ajo nitya shashato yam purano na hanyate hanyamane sharire. There are six qualities of the body, six things which are the inherent nature of the body. That is, they come into existence, the bodies are born, and after some time, bodies, they start growing, they stay for some time, and after some time they start dwindling, or after producing some byproducts they dwindle and ultimately death. These are the six changes of the body. Now in this verse Krishna says these six changes are not present in the soul. That is why he says na jayate, the body takes birth, the soul doesn't take birth. Na mriyate, mriyate means what? The body dies but the soul doesn't die. Na mriyate. So these two qualities are not there in the soul, birth and death. Na jayate na mriyate va kadachin, it never happened, neither in the past, nayam bhutva bhavita, neither it's going to happen in the future, va na bhuya, nor it's happening now. So these six changes are not there in the soul, neither in the past, nor in the future, nor it's happening now. Some people may say, now the soul is not born, but sometime later the soul may be born. Now we don't see that the soul is born now, but somewhere the soul must have taken birth. So in this regard, we know that some people say God created us, but it's a wrong statement. God never created us. The Vedas say, Saha Asti, the Lord is there and we also exist along with Him eternally. It is not that we were created a particular period of time. This creation is only used for the sake of manifestation. Sometimes the living entity is the manifest, the world manifest, and we manifest ourselves in this world. So this manifestation is actually not creation. We existed even before the creation, and we are going to exist after the creation too. So this birth and death is to the soul, is to the body, not to the soul. And ajaha nityaha. Nityaha means what? It is eternal. It is permanent. It is that body grows. For example, you have the body. After some time, baby is born, it grows for some time. It is not that the soul starts growing. Now the soul is in the ant's body. When the soul grew up, it went into elephant's body. No, whether it is elephant body or ant body, the soul is having the same size, same concept. Nityaha. Shashatoyam. Now old age is also not for the soul. The body becomes old where the soul is as it is. It is Purana. Shashvatoyam Purano. even though it is the oldest, still it is maintaining its own position. Nahanyate hanyamane sharire. Nahanyate means what? It doesn't die. When the body dies, soul doesn't die. After explaining this, Veda Virashanam Nityam Ye Yena Majamavyam Katam Sapurusha Partha Kam Gatayati Hantikam. So in the next verse, Krishna says that how the soul is not only the killer, not only the killer, but is also not killed. So some people have this idea, the soul doesn't die. It's true. That is what Krishna told. And now here Krishna says the soul not only is killed, but he is not the killer too. Now, what is the meaning of killer? We have this idea of I killed someone, I beat someone, I did it. But here Krishna says the soul doesn't do. So somebody comes and slaps you. He says, Krishna told in the Bhagavad Gita that soul doesn't do. Soul has not slapped you. I have not slapped you. Who did it? So this is where an important philosophical point comes into picture. Who is the doer? Well, a little bit technically we'll discuss this point. Suppose, for example, you have eaten something in the breakfast in the morning, you are thirsty, you drank water. Now who drank water? Did the soul drink water? Was the soul thirsty? If the soul is not thirsty, then who drank water? Who felt the satisfaction drinking water? It's a very, very important point. Like we all say that I did this. I am thirsty. I am hungry. I came from home. Who is that I? That is the subject matter in the next few verses. We'll not go verse by verse till the next few verses because I'll just discuss the subject matter in very short. When I mean to say I, it refers to what? Does it refer to my body? Does it refer to my mind? Does it refer to my intelligence? Does it refer to my false ego? Does it refer to my soul? It refers to what? Take a simple statement. I am thirsty. Now who is thirsty? Is the body thirsty? If the body is thirsty, we just now discussed the body is unconscious. So how can it feel the thirst? And mind is also matter. How can this mind feel the thirst? And on the other hand, if you say the soul is thirsty, how can the soul feel thirsty? Because the soul is spiritual. It wants only spiritual things. How can something material affect the soul? So it's a very, very deep philosophical point which we are discussing. We become so unconscious about it. Being unconscious about this simple word which we use every day, that is called ignorance. When we say, I am thirsty, I am hungry, I am feeling good, who is that I? Now if you say, that I refers to the soul, then is the soul hungry? Is the soul thirsty? Suppose you are drinking water. Now you drank water and say, oh, the thirst of the soul has been quenched. So the thirst of the soul has been quenched, is it that the soul is thirsty? Does it want water? Now where is the thirst? Who is feeling that thirst? For that, we have to know that consciousness. Remember last time we discussed about consciousness. Consciousness is a symptom of soul. Like there is bulb in one place, and the bulb is emanating light, which is called consciousness. In the same way, the soul is there in the region of the heart and it is emitting a light called consciousness. It is the consciousness which makes us feel different things. Heat, pain, pleasure, etc. You are feeling so cold. Why you are feeling so cold? Because consciousness is present in the body. And you should know that the soul is distinct from its consciousness as much as the bulb is distinct from the light which emanates. We say the light is a light. Actually, it's not light, it's bulb. From the bulb, light is emanating. So now what is happening is, this consciousness, when it is emanating from the soul, it gets mixed with the modes of nature. The modes of nature are what? Sattva-guna, Raja-guna and Tamaguna. Srila Prabhupada, he compares this to water and dirty water. When the rain falls and mixes with the mud, and we say this is muddy water. Though it is water, it is muddy water. In the same way, consciousness, when it is mixed with the modes of nature, it becomes contaminated. So that contaminated consciousness is known as chit. Now, we should understand, there is a distinction between chit and the soul. The soul is me, the original I. But the soul is emanating a light called consciousness. This light called consciousness, when it is mixed with the modes of nature, that is sattva, rajas, tama. Suppose more predominance of tamoguna is there. You give him a nice, wonderful sweet and rasgulla and something sattvic, he says, it's so horrible, I don't feel good. Suppose you give the same thing to a person whose consciousness is primarily in mode of goodness, he says, so tasty. Now here the question arises, if everybody is so, and all are same, why is it that everybody should have, everybody don't have the same liking? Why there are two different natures? Even twins, they may look alike, but they may have different natures. Where is this distinction of different natures coming from? If everybody is soul, if all are same, where is the distinction coming from? Somebody liking something, somebody doesn't like something. Like even your medical doctors, you give an injection to one person, he becomes all right. The same injection you give to other person because of the same disease, the disease may increase because that body is not able to accept this kind of injection because he is having some allergy toward particular certain things. So where is this distinction coming from? Where are the differences in natures and desires coming from? Two people may like to drink milk, but one likes hot milk, one likes cold milk. One likes milk with sugar, one doesn't like milk with sugar. So varied amounts, no two people in this world are same. So much of variegatedness, where it is coming from? It is like the color. You have unlimited colors. And within each color there are unlimited shapes. Where are they coming from? Basically from three colors. Red, blue and yellow. Different percentages of the mixtures of these red, blue and yellow, what happens? It gives rise to varied amount of colors. And each color had different shades and thousands and millions of shades, unlimited. So you can compare these unlimited colors and shades to the unlimited desires, unlimited natures of people. When you mix the original three colors, that brings around unlimited number of colors, unlimited number of shades. In the same way, mixture of these three modes, sattva, rajas, tama. And where is it mixed with? In consciousness, which is technically known as chit. And that gives rise to so many different kinds of natures. And it is in that chit we are feeling. It is a chit where it is in contact with a particular sense, it feels hunger or thirst, etc., etc. Wherever the consciousness is focused on whichever particular organ, that is where the desire or satisfaction, feeling, all this comes. For example, you have a child, a small baby. Now, he got his finger hurt. He's crying, looking at the finger. All of a sudden, the mother comes and gives him chocolate. He stops crying. Why? Why he stops crying? Is it because the pain is lost? Pain is gone away? The pain is still there. But why the child stops crying? Because his consciousness is not directed towards that finger now. His consciousness is where? It is directed towards the chocolate. Now just see, where is the feeling then? Is the feeling in the finger? No, the feeling is not in the finger. The feeling is actually in the consciousness. In the pain, the feeling is in the finger. The finger is still paining. Why is he not feeling the pain then? Why is he smiling? Why is he laughing then? It's a very, very technical point which Krishna talks about in this particular section about consciousness. And he says that it is not the soul which actually is killed, neither it is the soul which kills. It is Arjuna, my dear Arjuna, it is a consciousness. That is why Srila Prabhupada named this organization as International Society for Krishna Consciousness. What needs to be changed is consciousness. What is the problem is, we try to change the activity. without changing the consciousness. Now here we are not making people to change their activities. Here we are wanting people to change their consciousness. Changing consciousness doesn't mean really actually change of consciousness. We want people to come back to their original consciousness. Now here Arjuna is having contaminated consciousness. Now Krishna, by speaking Bhagavad Gita, he wants to change Arjuna's consciousness, means he wants to bring Arjuna's consciousness back to normal. Like a patient comes to the hospital. Now the doctor changes the patient. Actually, he's not changing the patient. He is bringing the patient back to normal. That is why when somebody asks, "Oh, how is my mother? I've admitted my mother to the hospital." The doctor says she is back to normal. The doctor doesn't say we have changed her, isn't it? So in the same way, this Bhagavad Gita and International Center for Krishna Consciousness, we work on people's consciousness. Like the doctors work on the body and bring the body temperature back to normal. In the same way, the consciousness of the people, which have become abnormal now, it has to be brought back to normal. It is not that the structure of the body is changed by the doctor. No, the body is as it is. And the person is as it is. But the fever is brought back to normal. The same way, here, we advise people not to change their activity. You go on doing whatever you are doing, but change your activity. Change your consciousness. So the change of consciousness is a subject matter. That is why Krishna tells Arjuna, "My dear Arjuna, you are thinking there is a problem in your activity. If I kill, I'll get sin." The problem is not in activity, my Arjuna. The problem is in your consciousness. If you kill with the intention of enjoying the kingdom, that is sinful. But if you do the same killing with the intention of pleasing me, that is transcendental. Now we think there is some problem in we doing something. That is why we think of whether to do or not to do. But the problem is not in me doing something. The problem is what? In my consciousness, the intention behind which I am doing it. That is why Krishna is removing the misconception in Arjuna's mind. Arjuna was thinking that this war is the problem. But here, Krishna is convincing Arjuna, even if you kill Bhishma, you have not killed Bhishma, because the soul doesn't take part in the killing. So you kill, but with what intention you have to kill, that is to be understood. That is going to explain further in the next section of this particular verse, particular chapter. So, this Krishna consciousness means change of consciousness. Change of activity is not so much recommended. Change of consciousness is very much recommended. That is why Krishna explains further to Arjuna. Arjuna was convinced actually by this verse, but the 21st and the 22nd verse, he is very much convinced. He says, "Okay, I am very much happy with your point, but still the point is, you told the soul doesn't die. But you just now told the soul is in the body. So for example, if I put a bomb, of course now you have a bomb. Earlier there was astras. Now Arjuna was thinking that I have an astra. I have agnyastra, varunastra. So different kinds of astras are there. If I put the astra, the body is destroyed. Do you think the soul will be as it is? Without getting destruction, something should happen to the soul. For example, I am in my particular room. Somebody drops a bomb on the room. The room is destroyed. Something should happen to me also, no?" So Arjuna had his doubt. That is why Krishna, he clears this doubt. He says that Nainam chindanti shastrani, Nainam dahati pavakha, Nachainam kledayanti apu na shoshayati marutha. Arjuna, don't worry. You throw, what is it? Nainam chindanti shastrani. Shastra, shastra means weapon. The physical weapons like a sword, the arrow, the bow and arrow, they are known as shastras. So even if you cut the body of Bhishma, the soul is not going to be cut. This word shastra is a very significant word. Shastra, astra, shastra, shas dhatu. Shas means what? Control. So good citizens are controlled by shastra. Good children are controlled by words. Just my mother, father says something, the children, they accept it. They are controlled by words, sweet words. If somebody is not controlled by words, then he is considered to be an animal. If you go and tell the buffalo, oh buffalo, please don't do this. Do you think the buffalo will hear? No, buffalo will not hear that. So then you have to take a stick to the buffalo. That is why those children which children not considered to be good children, just by hearing, if they listen, then they are considered good children. Otherwise, they don't hear, then take the stick, because their consciousness is like the buffalo consciousness. By speaking, they won't hear, so then take the stick. So that is why Shastra is there. Shastra means that I use a weapon to control. Words are not effective, then use a weapon to control. So now when the war means, here Krishna tried to explain to Duryodhana, Krishna tried to explain to the Kauravas, many people, Bhishma tried to explain, Vidura tried to explain, when words became ineffective, what is supposed to be used? Weapons. So war is not something bad. Like mother beating the child is not something bad. Now these days I heard, even in Bombay it has come. In America it seems, the child goes and complains, the mother is scolding me or abusing me, the mother is put in the jail. that child who doesn't get beatings from the mother will not be a good boy when he grows higher. One who has got good beatings from the mother, then that boy will be okay. He will be peaceful, he will be happy in his life. It has been seen. Those children who get nice beatings, nice thrashings, they are peaceful. When they become old, when they become youth, and they are responsible people. So now, it is not bad, child getting beaten, or war is not something bad. For that, I would like to relate you a small story regarding that. Since this December book distribution marathon is going on, about Bhagavad Gita. I think I told this story, I don't know whether I told or not. During the book distribution marathon, it so happened that in Calcutta many years back, devotees were thinking how to distribute more and more books. There was one intelligent devotee. He heard the news that at that time there was one big leader in the world. He was a PLO leader, Palestinian Liberation Organization leader. His name was Yasser Arafat. He was a big personality at that time. So he had come to Calcutta. His first visit to India, he was in Calcutta at that time. So this devotee wanted to take some advantage. So he took a Bhagavad Gita and went to the hotel where he was staying. Very high class security was there. Then somehow he was just hiding somewhere. And Yasser Arafat, he came down the stairs, walking down with tight security. Somehow he could break the security cordon. And then he went to Yasser Arafat and gave the Bhagavad Gita to him. And told this Bhagavad Gita. The Yasser Arafat took this book in his hand and told, no, I am not interested in religion, I am interested in war. Then this devotee told, our God says you should fight. He sees the book and he sees the chariot and says, is it? I will read it. Had a photograph. Next day there was a picture. Next day there was a picture. Yasser Arafat's Bhagavad Gita as it is, and a devotee giving it to him. So big publicity. Many people bought this Bhagavad Gita. Just imagine, Yasser Arafat taking Bhagavad Gita. So people think war is bad. So so-called non-violence movement, that is actually not very much appreciated from the spiritual point of view. Everything has got its significance, provided it has been used in the proper place with proper intention. Like mother beating the child. Actually, mother beating a child is out of love, out of her affection. It is not something bad. So activity, there is nothing bad in the activity. Even the bad activity is not bad, provided it is done with a good intention. But even a good activity done with a bad intention is bad. Like Duryodhana. Duryodhana was feeding all the Brahmanas. And he invited Durvasa and all his disciples, thousands of disciples. And he fed the Brahmanas, he pleased the Brahmanas, Duryodhana. Very nicely he fed the Brahmanas. And after that, when he was very much pleased, Durvasa asked Duryodhana, what boon you want? Then he told, what else I can get? The very fact that you all came and purified my house, that's a big thing. But I have a small desire. The benefit which I got, I want that my brother Yudhishthira Maharaj should also get it. He is in the forest. Please go there. So just see, what Duryodhana is doing here. But what is the intention? The intention is Durvasa is a very angry person. Now when he goes to the forest, my five brothers are there in the forest, they have nothing to feed. And all these 10,000 people will go there with his disciples, Durvasa will go there. Anyhow, they have nothing to feed. Then Durvasa will become angry and Durvasa will curse. So Duryodhana was doing a very good activity, isn't it? Sending the Brahmins so that Yudhishthira Maharaj will get the blessings. But what was the intention? The intention was going a little bit higher and taking a topic of Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu here. See, Krishna is the Supreme Lord. And devotion means to please the Supreme Lord, isn't it? Yes, to make Krishna happy. You find here Yashoda, she was feeding Krishna. She was feeding Krishna. Immediately she remembered, oh, I kept milk on the stove. She kept Krishna down and she ran so that she can take care of the milk. And because of this activity, Krishna became very angry. So this activity of Yashoda made Krishna angry. Krishna became displeased. Now, on the other hand, when Kamsa wanted to kill Krishna, he was fighting with Krishna. Krishna was so happy. At last, I could show my strength. So, when Krishna was fighting with Kamsa, he was so happy to fight with Kamsa. Now, Kamsa's activity pleased Krishna. Yashoda's activity displeased Krishna. Now, tell me, who is a better devotee, Kamsa or Yashoda? Definitely, if you see from the activity point of view, Kamsa is best because he pleased, his actions pleased Krishna. Whereas Yashoda's actions displeased Krishna, but still you don't say that Kamsa is a pure devotee and Yashoda is not a devotee. But you exactly did the opposite. It says Kamsa is a demon and Yashoda is a pure devotee, loving devotee of Krishna. Because Yashoda's intention was to please Krishna. Though her activity did not please Krishna, intention was to please Krishna. Here on the other hand, you have Kamsa, though his actions pleased Krishna, his intention was not to please Krishna. That is why, here coming back to the point of Nainam Chindanti Shastrani, Krishna tells Arjuna, Arjuna, even if you throw a shastra on him, the soul is not going to be cut into pieces. Even if you cut this with the sword, the body of Bhishma into many, many parts, the soul will be as it is. Nainam chindanti shastrani. Nainam dahati pavakaha. Now, apart from there is astra, there is shastra. There is shastra and there is astra. What is the difference between shastra and astra? Shastra means weapons, physical weapons, which can be grossly perceived. Astra means the subtle mantras which are chanted to make the shastras more powerful. If you just take an arrow and then shoot the arrow, what would happen? The arrow would pierce the body of a person. One person may die, maybe two, three people may die because of that. But with great concentration, if somebody invokes the wind god or the rain god or the fire god, then when with that invocation, with that astra, these shastras are shot, what happens? This arrow would create a particular effect. Suppose the fire god has been invoked, Agni Astra. That arrow would go and create a big fire on the enemy people. Now here, Krishna tells Arjuna, even though you shoot the astras, Agni Astra, Nainam Dahati Pavakaha. Oh Arjuna, even if you shoot an arrow with a astra of Agnyastra, Nainam Dhadi Pavaka, Pavaka means fire. The fire will not burn. Maybe Bhishma's body may burn away, but the soul will not burn in fire. Nachainam Kledayan Tyapaha. Even if you shoot Varanastra, Apaha means what? If you shoot Varanastra, still the body of Bhishma would get wet, but the soul would not get wet. Going further, Na Shosheti Marutaha. If you shoot Marutastra, Maruta means Vayastra, still Bhishma's body will be driven away in the wind, but the soul will not be affected. Why? Because the soul is Akledyoyam Adahyoyam Akledyoshoshayevacha. Nitya sarvatakatara sthana rachuloyam sanatana. Why? The nature of the soul is achedyoyam. It cannot be cut into pieces. Achedya. Same thing he says. Adah yoyam. The soul cannot be burned. Akledyo. It cannot be, you cannot moisten the soul. Asosya evacha. It cannot be dried. Because soul is nitya. It is eternal. It is sthanu. It is at one place. Sarvagata sthanu achaloyam sanatana. It is immovable. Now you may say the soul is immovable. Now when I came from my house to this hospital to hear the lecture, the soul, you kept it there and came or what? What is the meaning of immovable? The soul is achala. Immovable means the soul doesn't exist in the three-dimensional plane. The body is in three-dimensional plane. For example, you are going from here to a temple or going to your house, which is a kilometer away. The body moved for 1 kilometer. Because this world, what we are staying in, existing, what we are perceiving, it is having three dimensions, length, breadth and height. And our body is also conditioned to the three dimensions. So the movement is there in these three dimensions. Whereas the soul is not in the three-dimensional plane. It is in the spiritual dimension. Since it is in the spiritual dimension, what is the nature of the soul? The soul is immovable. It doesn't move. It doesn't move in the material plane. Movement is calculated in the material platform. But the soul being spiritual, it is totally on the spiritual plane. So you cannot say the soul moves. That is why Krishna says here, achaloyam sanatanaha. Now after explaining all these points, Krishna comes and then talks about the wrong philosophies to Arjuna. Because Krishna's whole purpose was to explain to Arjuna what you should fight. Somehow or other you should fight. Now, by using the right philosophy of body and soul, matter and spirit, the distinction between matter and spirit, Krishna explained to Arjuna, with even if you consider knowledge, according to the proper knowledge, you should fight. Even if you consider improper knowledge, still you have to fight. For that he says that Atachainam Nityajadam Manyan Nityam Va Manyate Vritam Manyase Vritam Tathapi Tvam Mahabhavo Nainam Shochitam Manasi. Tathapi. Now Krishna says Tathapi. What is the meaning of Tathapi? Tathapi means even though. Even though you accept a wrong philosophy, you should fight. Then what to speak of right philosophy? Even though you are a fool, you should do it. Then what to speak if you are intelligent? Something like that. Even fool will be able to understand and want to speak of you, intelligent person. In the same way, oh my dear Arjuna, even if it according to wrong philosophy is accepted, you are supposed to fight with Bhishma. Then want to speak of right philosophy. Till now he has spoken about the soul being eternal and the body being temporary. Now Krishna says, even if you consider Atha chainam nitya jatam nityam va manyate mritam. Even if you consider the soul to be eternally born and eternally dies. Means what? Even if you consider the soul is born, the soul dies. Still, tata apitvam mahabahu. Now there are some atheistic philosophers who talk on soul, but their conception of soul is totally wrong. They even talk about rebirth, but they talk about the soul being born at one particular time. And they talk about the soul dying forever and forever. So these kind of philosophers, they are atheistic. And these philosophers, though people don't know their names, that philosophy is very much prevalent these days. If you go and talk about people, why didn't you come to Bhagavad Gita class? Why didn't you take up spirituality? Kaun deka agla janam, just enjoy. They know, they say that this life ends with this body. The body dies, the soul also dies. So who knows, next life and all. As long as body is there, just go on enjoy. So there was one philosopher called Charvaka, many years back, thousands of years back. This Charvaka had this philosophy, beg, borrow or steal, and drink ghee. Beg, borrow or steal, drink ghee. If you don't have to enjoy anything, you go and beg somebody, I want to enjoy, give something. If nobody gives something, what do you do? Borrow. Give me something, I'll give you back later. I don't know when I'm going to give back, but give me and enjoy. Anyhow, after enjoyment, if you die, who cares? Forget about it. Borrow. And still, if you borrow, if they don't give, what do? Steal. Beg, borrow, and steal, and drink, give. At least, it was many years back, they told, beg, borrow, or steal, and drink, give. Now they say, beg, borrow, and steal, and drink liquor. Charvak, when he told about this, beg, borrow, and steal, and drink, give, though he spoke a wrong philosophy, he knew by drinking ghee, one day or the other he will get some intelligence to understand the soul. Beg, borrow, or steal and drink tea, coffee, liquor, all these things. This is going to even spoil, worsen your intelligence. So just imagine, in the olden days, even though they spoke some wrong philosophy, there was some dharma in it. Some dharma was there. Now even though they speak the right philosophy, these are dharma. So that is the difference in culture. If somebody follows a Vedic culture, then there is some hope, if not today, even though it is a wrong philosophy spoken by a person following Vedic culture, there is some hope today or tomorrow. What will happen? They will understand, they will have some concept, right concept of the soul. So now we're coming back to this point of wrong philosophy, of soul dying at the time of death. The time of body is death, the soul dies. This is a wrong philosophy. Why? Why is it a wrong philosophy? Because not only it is a wrong philosophy, this philosophy is going to create a big chaos in the society. Just imagine if there is no fear of rebirth. Like if there is no compulsion for you to repay the loan what you have taken. What will happen? Big chaos in society. So there are Lokayatikas, Vaibhashikas, like that there are many philosophers who are akin to Buddhist philosophy. Actually, Buddhist philosophy is atheistic philosophy. Like somebody met me in the train. Recently I was traveling train, somebody met me. Then I was just chanting and I was reading. Then that person came and told, he started speaking to me and then told me, we are Buddhist. Then I asked him, what do you do, what is your philosophy? What do you say? Then he told that, what is there? Both same only. You, we, all same only. Everything is same. Then, okay, well, if it is same, what you want to tell, please tell. Bas, abhi aap jo kar rahe, what you are doing, that only we also do. We also chant. Then after chant, what you attain? You also go to God. Then I told, you are not Buddhist. No, we are Buddhist. Then I told him, according to Buddhist philosophy, there is no God. And the soul has death. No, we believe in rebirth. Ultimately, it dies. That is what is your philosophy. If you don't know, please listen for me. I will speak about Buddhism too. So many people, they say, I belong to this ism, that ism, but they don't know what their ism is going to be speaking. They don't know their own philosophy. Buddhistic or atheistic philosophy. So actually, this whole country which was ruled by Ashoka at one time, just imagine, the entire country, he made a rule that everybody should be atheist. And now you have this great Indian flag. In the middle there is a chakra, Ashoka chakra. There are 24 spokes in it. You know what that represents? Buddhism. The 24 aspects of Buddhism. Just imagine. We say, Mera Bharat Maan. Is Bharat mein sab log Bhagwan ko maante hai. But the agenda is saying, no God. It's truth. Ignorance is bliss. What to do? Go further. Now there are so many wrong philosophies. Krishna says further, Jatasya Dhruva Mrityu Dhruvam Janvatasya Cha Dasmadapyari Arti Rattam Suchita Manasa. My dear Arjuna, anybody who is born is supposed to die. If you don't kill Bhishma now, tomorrow is going to die. Just kill him now itself. Just see how horrible it is. Anyone is going to die tomorrow. Like a very nice, obedient son. He has learned this verse. Father falls sick. Father says, Beta, take me to the doctor. I may die. Anyway, you are going to die, whether here or in hospital. Why you die here only, na? Jatasya hi dhruva mrityur. It happened once. This knowledge of the soul is such a thing, if it is not used properly, it can be misused also. There's one boy who used to attend my children program many years back. One day, mother came, the boy, and then told me, small boy, told him, Prabhuji, aapne kya sikha diya inko? What did you teach him? I told, what happened? I took this boy to the hospital, and my father-in-law, his grandfather, was very sick. He was in the ICU. And this boy went and told the grandfather, don't worry, grandfather. Jatasya hi dhruvo mrityu. For a person who is born, death is certain. And don't worry, for a person who is dead, he is going to take birth. Just imagine. Grandson telling the grandfather that in ICU. And grandfather is like stunned. What to do? So he spoke the truth. but the wrong place, that is the problem. Maybe he would have died after 1 week, he would die now itself, hearing his own grandfather speaking this thing. So jatasya dhruvam mrityur dhruvam janmrutasya cha tasmad aparihartyarthe. These kind of philosophies, a person who is born, he is going to die. And once he dies, he is born again. And once he dies, born again. In this way, the cycle goes on and on and on. So don't worry about birth and death because it's going to go anyhow. Just enjoy. Even if you accept this wrong philosophy, Krishna says that, Arjuna, you need to fight. Because this body of Bhishma, if you don't kill today, anyhow it is going to die. Going further. Avyaktadini bhutani vyaktamadhyani bharata avyaktanidhananyeva tatraka parigevana. See, Arjuna, you have not studied scripture. Scriptures, it is said, everything was unmanifested before. Now, it has become manifest. Now, again, everything becomes unmanifest. So, this cycle is going to go on and on and on. So, you kill Bhishma. Because Bhishma was unmanifest before. Now, after some time, it's going to become manifest. So, if you unmanifest him now, anyhow, he's going to manifest later. So don't worry, just go and fight. So in this way, Krishna, he goes on explaining about different wrong philosophies. Even accepting wrong philosophy should be the reason for Arjuna to fight, then what to speak of accepting right philosophy. And ultimately, he says, Ascharyavat paschit kaschidenam, Ascharyavat adityadeva chanyaha, Ascharyavat chena vanyashnoti, Shutvapyenam Vedanachev Kashchit. The soul is amazing. The subject matter of soul is so amazing, my dear Arjuna. Shrutvapyenam Vedanachev Kashchit. Even though one hears about the soul, he cannot understand until unless he knows that the soul is amazing. If you don't know the soul is amazing, you will be amazed. And the only way to know the soul is amazing is to hear it from a spiritual master. When you hear about the amazement of the soul from the spiritual master, then only you will be able to understand the nature of the soul, that it is there as so small in the body of an ant, at the same time the soul is there in the body of an elephant, such a huge body of the elephant is being moved by a small, minute soul. But it's such an amazing thing, such a wonderful knowledge, we are so unconscious about it. That is our misery. Summarizing the entire section from the 11th verse till the 30th verse, Krishna summarizes the knowledge of the soul in the 30th verse of the 2nd chapter. Dehi nityam adhyoyam dehe sarvasya bharata tasmat sarvani bhutani natvam sochitam arhasi tatvam sochitam arhasi. Don't worry, be happy. Why? Because the soul is dehi nityam, it is eternal. Avadhyoyam, it cannot be killed. Dehe sarvasya bharata, it is there in everybody's body. Tasma sarvani bhutani natvam sochitam arhasi. Don't worry, be happy. You see, sochitam arhasi. This is the subject matter of the Bhagavad Gita. The beginning, middle and end, everywhere you will find Krishna telling, don't worry, be happy. But at the same time, he has used one clause called arhasi. Arhasi means what? Which is fit to be thought about, think about it. But the thing which is not fit to be thought about, don't think about it. So, the summary of the entire section is that be carefree, don't be careless. Being careful about the spiritual subject matters, we become carefree in our life. Otherwise, if you are not very careful in spiritual subject matter, we become careless in our life and mess up our life. Like a student. When a small boy going to school, if he is very careful in his class, he is very careful in studying, he can be carefree during exams. If he is not very careful in the class, if he is not very careful in his studies, what happens? And he becomes careless, what will happen? He will be in anxiety in examination. That is why the knowledge of the soul is so important. This section of the Bhagavad Gita, one should study again and again. As I told in many, many classes before, that we don't want to read Bhagavad Gita. We should study Bhagavad Gita. So we stop here. Next time we'll continue from 31st verse onwards. Hare Krishna. Yes.
Thank you very much for the wonderful explanation. I have a doubt. I mean, it was very clear the way you were explaining the importance of intentions and activities.
Yeah.
But the doubts that popped up in my mind is relating to what we hear about the law of karma. Like many times our intentions are good, but the actions we do, they hurt other people or they affect them negatively. And we are told that we get a negative form of karma for it, whether it is dealing with patients, taking care of patients, or even if innocent activity of walking on the ground and we are careless, as you said, and we step on some ants or anything. And we are told that though our intention is not to harm or kill the other living being, but we are told we get the law, according to the law of karma, we get the karma for it.
Very
so I just had some confusion and like
to make this clarity. Very nice question. If you remember, in a few classes before, we talked about a mother with good intention of making the child okay because the child was sick. She gave the medicines to the child, but the child became more sick. Mother intention was very good, compassion was there, but she did not have adequate knowledge. So we have spoken about the subject of having knowledge too. So intention is one thing, and to execute that intention you need to have proper knowledge too. So the present subject which we discussed now, it is the comparison between intention and activity. Of course, the intention should be accompanied with proper knowledge too. So if you have proper intention, at the same time proper knowledge, then activity, anything can be performed. Like for example, Arjuna. If his intention of fighting, at the same time he should have the knowledge of fighting too. It is not that he just has the intention and then goes just like unarmed, he will die there. So, our intention should be proper, knowledge should be proper, immaterial of the actions. Because Arjuna's problem was, he was thinking war is not good. The problem is not in the war. Like a mother thinking beating the child is not good. No, the activity is not the subject matter. The subject matter is what? The intention. But to fulfill that intention, you need to have the knowledge too. So, for example, you are trying to cure a patient. The intention should be proper. At the same time, you should have the knowledge of doing that too. Otherwise, anybody would come and try to, I want to cure the patient. Then, just imagine what would happen. That is the thing. Knowledge is also required.
So,
yeah.
if we are doing it with the best intention and
best with the knowledge,
then whatever are the results, we are not entitled to the karma of it.
True. That is what Krishna says in today morning's class. Karmanna eva adhikalaste ma phaleshu kadachana. That is it.
Really, you are talking about changing the consciousness. But you are saying like the example of the bulb. So if the bulb is white in color, the light will be white. So now we are talking of changing the white color of the light to blue color.
Nice question.
So how do we achieve that?
Take for example tube light. Tube light is always white. But you find a different effect because the covering on the tube light is blue or yellow or red. Maybe many wrappers of blue are there. Many wrappers of yellow are there. So, the bulb is producing only one color. But when it passes through the modes, passes through the different colors of paper, the effect is different. Soul is the same. Every soul is the same. It is producing the same consciousness. But when the soul is covered by the modes of nature and the consciousness is released through the modes, then that is different. That is what it is. So we are not talking about changing the color of the light. We are thinking of purifying, removing the layers of the modes of nature. That's what it is.
So when we are saying Krishna consciousness, that means we are changing the modes, then
we are removing the modes or purifying the modes. That is what we are talking about.
How do we purify the modes?
How do we purify the modes? That process is this. Because the modes, through the modes we act, through the modes we think. So we have to change our actions, change our thinking based on knowledge. Based on knowledge. So when we do that, then the change happens. Otherwise, it will not happen automatically. There's some people say, automatically everybody will become spiritual. Yesterday only I met a person, old person. When I was talking about children, youth, how it's happening, automatically everybody will become spiritual. How is it? Why didn't you tell your children, automatically they will become learned? Nothing happens automatic. Isn't it?
Second question was, we keep on talking about body and soul, but then we don't realize that we have soul.
That is the question. That is why Krishna did not stop the second chapter at this verse. Otherwise, this would have ended. 30th verse, he has given the knowledge. But now, he speaks further. Especially in the second chapter, 39th verse, he says, Yeshade Abhita Sankhe Buddhi Yogam Trimam Sulam. Now you hear about Buddhi Yoga. Now, why he spoke further from 40th verse onwards? Because whatever he has spoken, that has to be realized. So realization of the knowledge which he has spoken can only happen when somebody acts on the platform of knowledge. So the actions based on the knowledge which he has given to realize the same thing what he has spoken, that is called Karma Yoga. That we are going to discuss in the next verse, next class onwards. Last question, because we need to vacate at 10:30, is what I have been told. Who is the real doer? That is the subject matter in the third and the fifth chapters, but since you asked, I will explain that. We have three subjects for discussion here. One is body, the soul, the Supreme Lord. Three. Now among the three, one should be the doer. But in the third and the fifth chapter, Bhagavad Gita, you have an explanation of saying that how all the three are doers and all the three are non-doers. How all the three are doers? We all know, without the sanction of the Lord, even a blade of grass doesn't move. So somebody has murdered someone. Who did it? Until he sanctions, how will it happen? When not a blade of grass can move, murdering, how can it happen without God's will? People say that. You go and ask them, why didn't you come to temple? Bhagavan ka ichcha hua toh aayega. So they are not speaking wrong, but they don't have a proper understanding of what they are speaking. Now here, the God, Supreme Lord Krishna, is a doer in the form of sanctioner, upadrashta, anumanta, anumati. Without his sanction, I cannot lift a hand, what to speak of doing anything. Now, matter, the body is a doer. How the body is a doer? Because without the body, nothing can be accomplished. Like, he cut the tree. How did he cut the tree? Without an axe. So, axe cut the tree. Without the axe, he cannot cut. So, axe cut the tree. But ultimately, who cut the tree? The person, the soul. Now, here comes soul or chit. The soul doesn't physically participate in any material actions. So it is a chit, which is responsible, consciousness, which is responsible for the actions. Ultimate responsibility is consciousness. Though there is a part of the body, there is a part of, played by the Lord, ultimately it is a consciousness. That is where the change of consciousness is done. Ultimately, the three things are there, that is the body, the soul, and the Supreme Lord. All the three are not duals also. How? The soul is spiritual. What it has got to do with matter? The Supreme Lord, anyhow, is there in the spiritual world doing past things. It has nothing to do with matter. The body is inert. How does it do? So in this way, there is a lot of discussion about who is the doer. But summarizing the entire thing, it is the consciousness which matters. That is why Srila Prabhupada named this as Krishna consciousness. That is how Cheto Darpana Marjana, change of consciousness by doing certain activities of sadhana. Okay. Yeah.
After everything is over, I mean the soul goes back to the spiritual world. Yeah. There are no worlds.
When the soul back goes back to the spiritual world, and all the souls back, what will happen to the material world? Okay, after liberation. That means your question is, after going back home, back to God, what happens to the soul? Who is the doer there? There is no question of any doer. There is only experience of the soul, anandamaya, anandamaya abhyasat. But going to the spiritual world means there you are participating in the past sense of Krishna. There is no material senses, there is no body, there is no material mind, there is no material intelligence, and there is no chit, means contaminated consciousness not there, there is only pure consciousness. What does consciousness do? It only perceives, experiences bliss. That is what it is.
There is no material body, there is spiritual body.
Yes, spiritual body. Yeah.
So the soul is there, the body is there, the Lord is also there, the body is also there. All the three factors of the
No, no. There, the soul and the body are not different from each other.
Spiritual.
Yeah. The soul assumes its original position of being a spiritual body. Here, there is a distinction between body and soul. But there, the soul is the body. The body is the soul. There is no distinction there.
Three factors or two factors?
Only two. Krishna and the soul. Nothing.
Then
who becomes the doer? Huh? There is no question of any doing because everything is spontaneous there. Here, I think, will and do. There is nothing like that. Like for example, I have to drink water, then I have to do all these things, all the activities here. There is endeavor, so many things are involved. Because there is a karana, there is a instrumental this thing. There is no instrument there. There is no gap between you and Krishna. So it is direct. Okay, stop. Hare Krishna.